This week marks the 100th anniversary of the Negro Leagues. We'll be taking a closer look at the people who changed the game.
No doubt, you can't say Negro Leagues without the Kansas City Monarchs, right? And when they weren't stepping up to the plate, they had their plate filled with barbecue. I sat down with Ollie Gates of Gates Barbecue as he explains why we should honor their legacy. When it comes to the Kansas City Monarchs of the Negro Leagues, you may have read about it, you may have even heard about it.
You're talking about what you read or what you heard. I'm talking about what I live. I live with those guys.
And so restaurant owner Ollie Gates.
It looks good.
Yeah, that's a good looking stuff. We do good stuff.
Stepped up to the plate.
I was raised on 19 of Vine.
To give his firsthand account, Ollie was a teenager working the counter in the 1940s.
You see those guys and with the big cars and the tall hats and the good looking women, and of course, there was something for you to look forward to. The only joints that stayed open after hours were all the baseball players coming up with barbecue joints.
And they made their presence known when young Ollie was behind the counter.
I tell you, see, you got to understand the ego that a lot of those guys had, you know. They were somebody, and they knew it, and everybody loved them, and they thought everybody loved them.
But his first encounter with a few of the Monarchs wasn't exactly what you would call the royal treatment.
Buck and Satchel and a couple other guys came to the joint after the joint's closed, 1:30 in the morning. They're pretty happy, you know, they've been drinking, so everybody was pretty happy, feeling pretty good. And so everybody was kissing and hugging somebody, but Buck came in the joint, and Buck, you know, actually, Buck thought he was cute. Yeah, you got to understand. Buck had a little streak in him. He thought he was cute. But my dad didn't think he was too cute, you know what I mean? So Buck came in, Mama there in the restaurant that night. Buck grabbed my mother, hugged a big hug. Hello there, sweetheart, and whatnot. My dad said, hey, wait just a second there, my friend. Back up. You don't hug my wife like that, you know what I mean?
His relationship with the legendary Buck O'Neill was contentious at best during his teens and early 20s. That would definitely change over the years as they became best of friends.
I had a beef with Buck because my dad had a beef with Buck, you know what I mean?
Buck was just one of several Monarchs to come through these doors, and they all left their impression on a young Ollie.
A guy named Willard Brown, big lazy. He was a center fielder. Another guy that I admired a lot too, named Frank Duncan, was a great catcher. But the best catcher of all of them was Mickey Tabor. Mickey Tabor was the first guy I ever seen that would catch the ball, and if a man was the kid got a single, he'd run behind the first baseman and back him up before the man got there with the ball. Oh, he was fast. And then my other favorite on the Monarchs team was a guy named Jesse Williams.
Jesse Williams played second base. That is, until a guy by the name of Jackie Robinson came to the Monarchs. Williams then moved to shortstop to make room for the future Brooklyn Dodger and Trailblazer.
Well, he had a great personality. The one that didn't have a personality, probably one of the best third basemen you ever wanted to see, was one named Hank Thompson. And Newt Joseph. Newt Joseph was the back catcher for the Monarchs, but he was like second string. But he owned Monarch Cab. And the Monarch Cab Company was the number one cab company in Kansas City in the black community. And of course, Hilton Smith, who backed up Satchel Paige, you know, he lived at 26th and Park, so he was like a neighbor too. And that boy's a Hall of Famer. Just neighbor, lived right down the street, around the corner.
And those players being so close, being able to even touch them, as Ollie says, well, that's why that community felt no task, no matter how great, was out of reach.
And you looked at those guys as somebody in the neighborhood that you look up to, a school teacher, you might look up to a preacher, you looked up to them as a baseball player. That was their profession. Well, that's what I think about black baseball players. See, we had legends and didn't even know we had legends. So then they were right amongst you. And so I think that the black kids right now should look at history like anybody else does and be proud of who you are. And those guys really made you proud. And the Negro National League allowed you to be somebody even if your color was a different than somebody else in the major leagues.
Which is why Gates says the Negro League Museum is more important than ever as we celebrate 100 years since the league was founded.
It's just for us to living, rather than those that died, to make sure that things are carried on.
You see, the Monarchs are as much a part of Kansas City history as barbecue.
Let me tell you, that's just a portion of my sit down with Gates. He had so many stories. The one that really stood out, deal, was about Sundays. Whenever there was a game on Sundays, you know, a lot of people go to church on Sundays. If there was a game at 1 o'clock, he tells me, and at 12 o'clock, the Reverend was still talking, the choir and everybody would get to move, and they say, Reverend, we got to go. We got to go see the Monarchs play.
How things change but stay the same. I bet it's the same way when the Chiefs play on Sunday
indeed.
I know Ollie Gates was cutting up.
Yeah, we're going to have a whole special this week leading up to the centennial. So just check our website, kshp.com/NLB100.